So I'm new to, I'm a computer scientist, roboticist, and one thing I've learned coming to this conference is coral reef ecosystems are extremely complicated. There are so many open questions on understanding how this ecosystem works and how best to restore it. It's like a continuously moving field. And what I'm trying to do here is present this robot I've been working on, present it as a tool which practitioners and scientists could use to monitor and understand coral reef ecosystem in different ways, right? Not just figure out how the benthic habitat is distributed, not just figure out how species are distributed, but also like, you know, phenomena which are dynamic, like how does like, you know, the sounds and visuals correlate with each other. I mean, maybe down the line, you know, figuring out like new ways to estimate what the best location to put, like implant a new coral should be, right? So that information is constantly changing, and the goal here is to develop a tool which allows us to allows practitioners to monitor reefs from multiple point of views and creatively use this tool without, you know, not make a very specific tool which just targets one aspect of the coral reef, but combine a bunch of different behaviors and come up with creative use of them. So some of the examples I'm going to talk about, this is not a complete list, but some of the things we are working on is like be able to do low altitude benthic surveys, be able to do automatically build habitat maps, do soundscape surveys, which can be a proxy for a lot of activities on the coral reef, tracking animals, which can tell you a lot about interspecies interaction. So I'll show you some examples of what we're doing and how it works and why it's new. So in terms of benthic surveys, a lot of them are done by divers. There are examples of them being done by robots. But what we have done, the Curie robot, it uses not just sonars, but also uses visual information, stereo camera system, to be able to estimate obstacles, and it's able to get much closer to the corals compared to most other robots. And as a result, you can get this much higher resolution imagery, which can be used in photo mosaics and build like complicated, large 3D maps of the reef. We can, some of you might be familiar with everybody's familiar that underwater photography is complicated. We lose a lot of like clarity in images. So there is an algorithm called the see-through algorithm, which was recently published like last year or 2 years ago, which models, you know, which is able to fix a lot of these things. Like, so, and in particular, there is, you know, given an image and a depth image, the see-through algorithm is able to model the backscatter and the attenuation. So backscatter is like the haze you get in the images underwater, and the attenuation corresponds to loss of red color, like with depth. So there's an algorithm which exists, but it's very, very expensive. It's designed for like post-processing, several minutes per image to compute those things. But we have recently been able to come up with an approach to make that happen in real time, right? We approximated using deep neural networks, and we can, as a result, we have this capability for a robot to, in real time, be able to observe color-corrected images. Which basically anything which builds on top of image processing, like classification, detection of habitats, all that stuff works now much better. We can take the imagery we collect, and we can, in real time, detect, not only just detect different habitat types, but also map them in space, right? So which is a pretty cool problem, right? So everybody has some definition of what different habitat types are, but it's a very qualitative definition. So we are able to, without any prior training, you can just throw the robot any reef in the world, anywhere on the planet, and it'll automatically just learn, hey, these are different types of environments, and how this is how they're distributed. So we can work on streaming data and in real time with no prior training. So an example of this type of survey might look something like this. So on x-axis, you see time, and for each time, you see these colors, which are like the habitat labels, which our algorithm can compute. And in this example, what you see is every time you see this blue blobs, that corresponds to a robot encountering a dense coral region. And so example 2, 3, and 5 images correspond to these blue blob areas. And you know, these type of regions, that correspond to these sandy patches. So we can automatically detect different types of habitats, which you can then robot can use to kind of target this data collection very rapidly to whatever you want to focus it on. And another, just to reiterate, we don't require prior training. We are not collecting lots of data ahead of time. This is on the fly. You throw a robot in a new place, it can sort of learn to do that, right? So it's a tool, general purpose tool, which allows you to be creative in how you monitor the reefs. Soundscapes are big in coral reefs. Like they are interesting. They give a lot of information about what's happening on the reef, right? So you can hear some sounds and invertebrate sounds, which correlate often with how healthy a reef is or how sick it might be, right? If you hear a lot of hustle bustle chatter, you know, there's a good sign, the good chance that it might be a healthy reef. And so my colleague at Woods Hole, Aaron Mooney, works on this idea. So one of the problems with monitoring soundscape underwater is currently, you know, people put hydrophone in the water over at a particular location. So that's great for giving you temporal variation, but not spatial variation. So for spatial variation, then you have to spread out all the microphones, right? So which does not scale well. The approach does not scale well. When you put it on a robot, the only robot where you can kind of robot where you can put a hydrophone is something like a glider, right, which does not make any sound of its own while it's moving. But underwater gliders are not really designed to operate in coral reefs, right? So they can't just go anywhere, get close to corals. So instead, our robot, what it does is we have developed this drifting behavior. So it moves around and then it drifts every now and then, turns off everything, listens, and then comes back alive, and then goes on. And we get data like this. This is a spectrogram. So this part is where the motors are on, everything is saturated, then we are drifting, and all of a sudden you can hear sounds of different animals in the environment, and then you can use that too for other processing if you need. Another cool capability of robot is, tracking animals. Imagine if you could track animals like, barracudas, which are apex predators, or lionfish, which have been causing havoc. Like, we don't know. Often so much of the devastation in reefs is caused by animals or not understanding the food chain properly. If you can track barracuda over here, we can sort of see what other animals is it interacting with. Like, we can sort of start building this model of how the food chain on a reef might work, like improve those models, right? So so inter-animal interaction. So that's one thing. But then we could also use the same type of trackers to, for example, understand relationship of animals with their habitat. What kind of habitat is particular animal interest likes to hang out in, right? And that gives them information about, like, if we can build these models, then if there's some storm happens, some climate change happens, we can also see the change in their behavior. And that's like another way of understanding effects of climate change and disaster. So again, like all the other previous ideas, our approach, we don't have to train it on a particular animal. We are using semi-supervised techniques and where we can track arbitrary animals even when the background is complicated, when the background is complicated, in coral reef here, an example of tracking lionfish, octopus, and angelfish, right? So we can make it work. So a quick example of the kind of things, how we can be creative with the kind of surveys we can do, right? So so this is a survey, a very simple survey we did. So on the top you see the audio, the soundscape the robot recorded. So you see these, every band corresponds to a drifting behavior where we are hearing things. And on that we detected the snapping shrimp clicks. We built a very simple classifier which can detect clicks, and we can get a distribution of the snapping shrimp click frequency, which is like a, you know, can give you some indication of abundance of them. Then at the same time, we at those locations, we are also observing images, and we have this habitat map of that particular region. And what we see is, clearly what we see is like, you know, where whenever we are on top of a dense coral region, the snapping shrimp frequency goes up, which is kind of like, which is known. This is not a new sort of hypothesis, but the point here is our robot makes analysis like this, coming up with evaluating hypotheses like that very, very easy, right? So we can just very quickly, we don't need anything specialized, years of training, collecting data, blah, blah, blah. We can just throw robots in there, target it at different aspects of the reef, and evaluate hypotheses, then figure out, you know, maybe relate that to where, how we should restore the reefs. Just to nail that point, we were able to, you know, observe, this is the snapping shrimp frequency observed. The black line is the observed one using acoustic data, and the dotted line is the predicting using visual data. So they match pretty well. So our robot is, in terms of hardware, extremely transportable and portable. You know, we designed it to fit in a Pelican 1650 case, so we can take it on an airplane very easily. It's under 70 pounds when packed. So we designed that, were like the constraints we designed it to be, to make it easily deployable in remote parts of the world. We use a lot of computing on board, like it's AUE, so a lot of deep learning algorithms running on board. So heat is an issue, so we designed it straight up to be able to support high-powered computing in its head. So it's, this is head that is removable. We can put different types of camera and computing systems in there. It's got modular payloads and images and audio, hydrophone array are like the main sensing modalities. In terms of deployment, we can deploy the robot by itself, or we can, optionally, we could tether it to a surface vehicle, which follows it around and it provides its global positioning and radio communication, acts as a relay. And it enables, and you don't have to do anything with the surface vehicle, it just follows it around, just works, but it just enables easy deployment. To summarize, you know, we have built this robot, lots of cool behaviors which are ecologically relevant, which allows us to put them in interesting creative ways together, and hopefully we can get much better rapid understanding of a coral reef ecosystem. Thank you.